for me. Carry the cross all the way for my sins to atone. Then they nailed him to the cross. Great was the pain and the loss. He suffered it all because he loved me. Because he loved me, my Savior died on a cross, was crucified. No greater love by mortal man has ever been known. I'll praise his dear name, he loved me so. Now I'm in his, he's mine, I know. He suffered it all because he loved me. Then they carried him away, placed him in a lonely grave. Surely they thought that this would be the end of this man. But on that third and glorious day, God came and rolled the stone away. He rose from the dead because he loved me. Because he loved me, my Savior died on a cross, was crucified. No greater love by mortal man has ever been known. I'll praise his dear name, he loved me so. Now I am his, he's mine, I know. He suffered it all because he loved me. He suffered it all because he loved me.
Thank you so much, Miss Becky. I love to hear her sing some of these old songs that I remember from many, many years ago. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Proverbs chapter 2, or there's sermon notes in the bulletin. If you don't have a bulletin, make sure you get a bulletin. You can follow along with us. The scripture will be in the bulletin and start with the notes as well. I've got a little joke on my phone. You know, Patty and I've been grandparents almost 2 years now. I think Emerson's birthday is coming up in a few days. Her party's this Saturday. So here's a little funny on my phone about grandparents. This little boy sitting next to his grandpa, and he says, "Grandpa, are you and Grandma rich?" And the grandpa says, "Yes, Nelson, we are very rich. Extremely wealthy, as a matter of fact." Then he says, "But only if your wealth is measured in Tupperware containers without lids." Today we're faced with more decisions than ever before. A multiple choice culture is what we live in. The problem is that sometimes a seemingly insignificant or trivial decision has a major life-changing impact on our lives. Sometimes little tiny decisions is like a giant door that swings on a small hinge. Sometimes some small decision in your life can completely change the direction of it. I remember one time I decided I was going to meet this girl that a friend wanted me to meet. And I was a youth pastor at the time, and she turned out to be this gorgeous, drop-dead, beautiful girl. And I said, "I've got to get to know this woman a little better." So we went out on our first date, and her name was Patty. Now, I wonder what would have happened if I hadn't decided to meet her, and what would have happened in the twists and turns of destiny. But that's what God had planned for us. He had it planned, all mapped out before the creation of the world. And here she lived 520 miles away from me. We've been married almost 29 years now. Throughout our lives, we make some good decisions and we make some bad decisions. Meeting Patty for me was one of the best decisions that I ever made. But like all of us, I've made some dumb decisions before. I've got a little short list of, here's some little research on some really bad decisions down through history. A guy named Sam Phillips one time sold a small recording company to RCA Records in 1955 for $35,000. That sounded like a lot of money back then. It sounded like a good deal. But it included concluded an exclusive contract with a young man named Elvis Presley. Bad decision. There was a high school girl that told Bill Gates, it's either me or the computer. Bad decision. Pausing briefly before answering your wife's question, do I look fat in this? Really, really bad decision. Now, what is the key to making wise decisions? Listening to God. In Proverbs 2, verses 1, 5, and 9, it says, my son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair, every good path. Every good path. If you want to make good decisions, listen to God. This morning we have a very practical message for you. We're going to look at 6 biblical, practical ways to test a decision. From time to time, people will ask you, well, how do you know when God is talking to you? How do you know what God wants you to do in a certain situation? So today we're going to look at some of the answers, 6 principles or guidelines for decision making. We need to teach these to our kids and our grandkids. These are how you figure out what God wants you to do. Number 1, the ideal test. The ideal test. Is it in harmony with God's Word? Ask yourself that question. Is it in harmony with God's Word? What I'm about to do, does God say it's okay to do in the Bible? Always, this is the very first test you want to look at. What does God have to say about it? In life, you have to decide what's going to be your ultimate authority. It really boils down to 2 choices. God's Word is going to be the authority for your life in which you base your decisions, or the world is what you're going to base your decisions on. The Word or the world. What God says or what other people say. If you base your life on popular opinion, on what is currently the end thing to do, you're always going to be out of date because it keeps changing every day. What used to be in yesterday will not be in today, and what's in today will not be in tomorrow. So the opinions of the world change quite frequently. On the other hand, if you base your life on God's Word, the Bible, the truth never changes. Truth is always true. So if God says something was wrong 2,000 years ago, then it was wrong 500 years ago, and it's wrong today. I don't care what political correctness says or what's given to us in the media. If God says it's wrong, it's wrong. It's always been, it always has been, and it always will be. If God says it's right, it will always be right. So you can either build your life on a shaky foundation that's consistently changing the opinions of the world, or you can build your life on what God says, which never changes, which gives you a solid foundation for life. If you reject, rebel, disobey, ignore God's principles, you're the one who gets hurt. You cannot just thumb your nose at God and get away with it. There's inevitably a reckoning. Anytime you violate God's principles, you're asking for trouble. So the first question, obviously, in a decision is, what does God say about it? If God says it's okay, then I'll do it. If God says no, then don't do it. It doesn't matter what anybody else says or thinks, or 99% of the world, or if 99% of the world is doing it. If God says no, I'm not going to do it. Sometimes in life when you're making a decision, you're in the dark and you don't know what to do. Do I do this or do I do that? You're in the dark until you get a flashlight for life. That's the Bible. Listen at Psalm 119, 105, a very popular verse. I know you've heard it before. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It is the flashlight for life. The owner's manual for life. It's it's life's big instruction book. The Bible is there for your benefit. So you ask, is what I'm about to do in harmony with God's word. Let's be honest, sometimes just understanding God's principles is very difficult from a human standpoint. Sometimes it seems like it doesn't make sense. And you know what else? You don't have to understand God's principles to be blessed by them. You just have to follow them. You don't have to understand why God says what he does. God is God and you're not. He can make any rules he wants because he's the creator and you're not. But if you cooperate with them, even when you don't understand them and you obey them, you will be blessed. And for many of you, you've walked with the Lord for many years and you know this to be true. I don't understand completely how electricity works, but that doesn't stop me from using it. I don't understand the physics of internal combustion, but it doesn't keep me from driving a car. You don't have to know why God has said what he has said in the Bible to benefit from it. All you have to do or know is if I follow it, he did it for my benefit, and I'm going to be blessed as a result. But if I ignore it, I'm going to be the one that gets hurt. The oldest temptation known to man is the temptation to doubt God's word. When we find something in the Bible that we don't like and we think it is a little restrictive or outdated or old-fashioned, then we start to doubt God's word and we start saying, does the Bible really say that you can't do that? Anytime you start thinking that question, you have fallen for the oldest trap in the world. It was Satan's original temptation, the one he used on Adam and Eve, the very first human beings. One day the devil comes to Eve and says, does God really say you shouldn't eat of this tree? The oldest temptation is to doubt God's word. Whenever you doubt God's word, you're getting in trouble. Whenever you doubt God's word, you're doubting his love. God, I don't think you love me. I don't think you know what's best. And you're headed down a very slippery slope. So when making a decision, the first test is what does God say about it? Number two, the integrity test. The integrity test. For the second test, you want to ask yourself the question, would I want everyone to know about this decision that I'm making? If you're making a decision and you worry about what other people are going to find out about it, then it most likely is a very good indication that it's a bad decision. Because bad decisions always lead to secrets, and those kind of secrets always leads to pain in our lives. Proverbs 10:9 says, the man of integrity walks securely, but he who takes crooked paths will be found out. Notice it doesn't say that he might be found out, or even that there's a high probability that you're going to be found out. It says you will be found out. So when making the decision, you have to have the integrity test. We've all seen how this works, how this happens. You're about to make a bad choice. You know it's a bad choice. You know it's probably not the choice you should make, but before you make the choice, you think to yourself, well, I'll go ahead and do it because no one will ever know. Immediately, the moment you make that choice, you start thinking, uh-oh, somebody's going to find out. And you feel the fear that comes from that. And that's when you violated this integrity test. The test of integrity is that your public life and your private life match. Well, what's in your heart and what's in your life are the same thing. Your walk and your talk, what you say and what you do are in harmony with each other. The truth is, when it comes to integrity, even if you can fool everyone else, you can't fool yourself. And if you violate your own conscience, you have to pay for that. James 4:17. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it, sins. Even if I know the right thing to do and I violate my conscience and choose not to do it, it is sin. So one of the questions to ask yourself when making any decision, can I do this with a clear conscience. Because every time you violate your conscience, it's a big mistake. Sometimes we think this way. We know we're about to do the wrong thing. We know we shouldn't do it, but this thought comes to our mind. Well, even though it's wrong, I know I'm doing the wrong thing, but I'm going to go ahead and do it because I know that God will forgive me. He's a forgiving God. What kind of God do you think God is? That I could go ahead and make a decision to do something that he says is wrong and it's not going to have consequences in my life. Does this mean that God does not forgive us for the wrong things that we do? Of course he forgives us. He's a forgiving and gracious God. But that forgiveness does not free us from the pain and the consequences that come from those bad decisions. You can be forgiven and still have regrets. You can be forgiven and still face the pain. You can be forgiven and still struggle with low self-esteem from that decision. You can be forgiven and still have the broken relationship because you made that decision. You can be forgiven and still lose the rewards that you could have had. Number three, the improvement test. The improvement test, will it make me a better person? 1 Corinthians 10:23 says, everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible, but not everything is constructive. Notice the freedom that we have as Christians. We have free choice. Everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. And not everything that builds you up is constructive. He's saying some things are not necessarily wrong, they're just not necessary. They're not essential. It's not a matter of good and bad, it's just a matter of what's good and what's the best. Most of the choices you make in life are not really between really bad, really good, and really evil. You don't get up in the morning and say, shall I read the Bible or shall I become an international terrorist? Those kinds of things do not cross your mind. Should I pray or become a drug addict? The issue is what's really best for your life. A lot of things aren't necessarily wrong. They're morally neutral, but they're just not necessary. So you need to go to a higher standard and ask, will what I'm about to do make me a better person? That's the improvement test. Some things may not be evil. Are they bad? No. Are they a waste of time if you spend too much time on them? Absolutely. Will they make you a better person? Absolutely not. In no way, shape, or form do they make you a better person. You are giving your life for something that may be a second-class cause. None of us, if you think about it, none of us approach the Bible neutral. When we come to read the Bible, we always read it from our bias, our background, our temperament, and we like to read into the Bible what we want it to say instead of letting it just speak to us. We like to find the verses that we like and ignore all the ones that we don't like. Rather than coming to God's Word with a humble attitude and saying, God, you know what's best for me, you know what's right for me, and I'm going to do what you say, whether it makes sense or not, because I want to be a better person. So you humbly submit to what he says. Number four, the independence test. The independence test. You ask yourself the question, with this test, could it become addicting to me? Could it become addicting to me? Could it begin to control and dominate my life? No matter how fun something is or how popular they are, if it begins to dominate your life and becomes an addiction, it's a bad decision. No matter how good something is for somebody else, if it dominates your life, it becomes addicting to you, it's a bad decision. 1 Corinthians 6:12 says, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. I'm going to decide not to do anything that dominates my life. I won't let anything master me, consume me, or control my life unless it's God. Of course we should do that if that is God. Now, why is this so important? Because whatever dominates your life eventually becomes your God. In the Ten Commandments, the very first one, God said, "You shall have no other gods before me." He knew how easily we could do this. He knew we'd get addicted to our idols. Now, we think of idols as those little stone statues that people back then put up on a shelf and worshiped. But we still have idols today. There's lots of things that we can get addicted to today. Can you become dominated by your work? Of course you can. Can you become addicted to money or sports? Can you become addicted to your cell phone hour after hour? Of course you can. Today there's over 2,000 classified addictions. You can be addicted to almost anything. You can be addicted to chocolate. So how do you know if you've fallen into that kind of addiction? How do you know if something's starting to dominate your life? The number one question you asked is this: what do I think about the most? What is it that when you're alone, when you're relaxed, you find yourself thinking about again and again? Paul says, "I've decided that I'm not going to let anything control my life like that." Only Christ should have that kind of place in our lives, the first place in our lives. He's the only one that's worthy of that. Anything else that we put in that place will eventually dominate and control and ruin our lives and control our time. But when we put Him in that place in our lives, He is the one who encourages us and enables us and empowers our lives. Number five, the influence test. The influence test. Will it harm other people? Will it harm other people? One of the biggest mistakes we make in life is we forget how much our actions influence and affect others around us. Every day you are tempted to make decisions that may be the best thing for you, but it could have a devastating effect on the people around you. You need to take the fifth test. Will it harm other people? That's the opposite of our culture. Our culture teaches us to think of yourself only. Think of what you need, what are your desires. The truth is, God expects you to think more than just yourself. God expects you to think of other people around you. The Bible says one day you're going to be judged by God on how your decisions affected other people. Because God takes this seriously. Romans 14, 12 through 13 says, "So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way." You may not like hearing this, but whether you like it or not, you are being watched. All the time, you're being watched by other people. There's no such thing as all it affects is me. That's a lie. Everything you do has an effect on somebody else, either directly or indirectly. We're all in this boat together called humanity. And if we're in this boat together and I decide to drill a hole in the bottom of the boat, will that affect anybody else? Everybody else gets affected by the hole that I drill. Those of you who are parents or grandparents should be especially aware that little eyes are watching you. And because of that, you want to be careful with what you say and what you do, because you're influencing not just your life, but the next generation. My little granddaughter, sometimes I cross my arms like this and I don't even realize it. And I look over there and she'll be mocking me. She ain't even two yet. I got pictures of her doing that on my phone. So you realize that your children are watching you. You show respect for authority. If a policeman pulls you over for a ticket, even if you think he's dead wrong, you treat him with respect because you know that your children are watching you. You don't call in sick when you're telling the family that you're going fishing. bring supplies home that you stole from the office for personal benefit, that you don't brag in front of your kids about all the ways you're ripping off Uncle Sam in taxes. The influence question says, how is what I'm doing going to hurt somebody else? As a neighbor, you need to ask, am I a good neighbor to the people around me who lives next door? As a Christian, you obviously should be interested in how you live because you're influencing other people, even people you don't know. People are watching you. There are going to be times in your life when you get cruddy service at a restaurant, or some waitress or some attendant or clerk is going to be rude to you, and every bone in your body says, forget you, buddy. And you want to say something smart alecky back and be rude back to them, but don't do it. Because sure enough, right behind you in line will be the guy who sat behind you in church last week, who's not a believer, and he's saying, well, if that's what a Christian is, forget about it. You can't just live life the way you want to. You have to be aware of how it affects other people. Romans 15, 1 and 2. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. Mature people limit their freedom for the benefit of others. Immature people don't. Number 6, the last one, the investment test. The investment test. Is it the best use of my life, or is it the best use of my time? Ephesians 5, 15 through 17 says, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. If you want to make the best use of your life, if you want to make your life count, if you want to make an impact with your life, you've got to do one thing. You've got to get control of your time. If you don't learn to manage your time, you're not going to get very far in life. You've got to learn to manage your time. We all have the same amount of time every week. 168 hours a week. So the greatest success and the worst failure in life had the same amount of time as you do. It's what you do with it that counts. Time is more important in your life than money. You can always get more money, but you can't get more time. You only have a certain number of days that you've been allotted in this world, and if you blow them, then you have to stop and say, is this the best use of my time? There are many activities that we shouldn't do, not necessarily because they're bad, not because they're questionable or evil, but because we want to maximize our time on the purpose that God put us on this earth for the life mission that he sent us here to fulfill. And we're going to talk about our mission some in the next couple of weeks as we close out this series. But if you don't figure out your life mission, if you never understand your life purpose, if you never figure out why God put you on this earth, you have absolutely no basis at all for your decisions. You're making them carelessly. You're just coasting through life. If you don't know where you're headed, any road will take you there. If you don't know your life mission, your purpose in life that God put you here for, you don't have a basis for your decisions. If you want your life to count, it must be focused on a mission. And you don't have time for everything. The good news is, God doesn't expect you to do everything. So don't feel guilty about it. On top of that, there's only a few things worth doing in the first place. Effective people figure out what's essential in life and what's trivial in life, and they spend more of their time doing the essential things and less time doing the trivial things. And think about this, when you're tired, you don't want to do the best thing. You want to do what's easy. You don't want to do the right thing. You want to do what's comfortable. That's why if you're really going to make something of your life, you've got to learn to get some rest. If you're not rested, you're tired all the time. So What are we trying to say today? Don't waste your life. Don't settle for second best. Don't go through life just existing, just copying, just getting by, just skimming through life. You were not put here in life just to coast. You were put here on this planet not just to drift, but God made you for a reason. He made all of us for a reason. Some of you are trying to figure out God's plan for your life. You'll never figure it out until you stop doing some of the things that are taking up all your time, so you will have time to listen to God. And we listen to God through looking into His precious Word and through the small, still voice of the Holy Spirit that will speak to us as we're in His Word and in prayer. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for our time today looking into Your precious Word. Father, we all have so many decisions to make in life, some major decisions and some even little small decisions that we make many times throughout the day. And Lord, we just need to pray for Your wisdom, that You would give us the wisdom to know what to do in every decision, because it affects more than us. It especially affects our families, our friends, our church family, and so forth. And Father, we just pray that we would all be faithful to what Your Word says and not so much what the world says to do. And Lord, we just thank You for Your guidance, for Your providence and protection and so forth, Lord, if we just follow what You tell us to do. And we thank You for loving us and giving Your Son to provide this for us through placing our faith and trust in Him as our personal Savior, Lord. We pray for invitation now for Your will to be done. In Jesus' sweet name we pray. Amen.
Our invitation hymn is hymn number 483. If you'll stand with me, we'll sing Footsteps of Jesus.
Buddy called me this morning. Buddy fell last night. And he went outside and fell and got, he said he got stuck between the porch and the house or something. He said it took him like 30 minutes to get him up. And so he's all banged up and bruised up and not feeling well at all. So pray for Buddy. Buddy's about to be 89, I think, getting up in years. Pray for Joanne. She's got a bunch of doctor appointments and treatments coming up. Jean Wallace, we thought was going to be here today, but she's going to have cataract surgery. I think she goes to the eye doctor the end of this month. Any other prayer requests from you that we need to share?
Same, Jane.
Doug, Becky?
Continue. Remember David as he goes to rehab.
Juanita's son and Benny and Becky's son-in-law, David, going to rehab when he broke his kneecap. Last Sunday, I asked you to pray for a family of Patty's a teacher, a little girl in her class. Her older brother is on life support, and I told you Sunday that they may have to take his arm off, and they did on Monday. But she's not heard much since then.
He's still in the hospital.
He's still in the hospital. He's probably still on life support. Well, he's not on life support anymore. They did take him off life support. We did hear that part. But he's still got a long road ahead of him. The little girl's coming to school, but she doesn't know anything. She knows he's in the hospital, but she doesn't know how bad it is. So it's kind of
this week. It's wrong.
Yeah, it's hard to know the everything going on with her not knowing the whole story. Jack Jackson, he was 96. He was my driver's ed teacher at MD Collins. And I saw that on Facebook. I hadn't thought about him in years, and he used to wear a bow tie.
Yeah.
And I wondered if he taught it at Campbell too. They said he lived in Fairburn. But he was my driver's ed teacher. So all these people on Facebook commenting on how what all he used to say about bald tires and so forth. In different things like that. He's a funny guy. All right, so pray for that family, and we'll turn it back over to Mr. Depp.
All right, our benediction is hymn 212, I Love You, Lord.